all be bliss. But every wound is treatable. We won't go under. We're gonna be all right.
Hello, everybody. I'm Mark Auerbach. This is ArtsBeat Radio TV special called How We're Doing, an opportunity to chat with people about how they're coping with the COVID-19 crisis, how they're making do, how they're socially distancing, and how they're moving forward. Our guest this morning, our first guest, is Elena Newport, who is the co-founder of the Capitol Steps. And for 39 years, the Capitol Steps have been performing in Washington, D.C. and around the country, putting the mock in democracy, political musical satire. Good morning, Elena.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing down in Washington?
Well, are you letting yourself go? I've been kind of letting myself go.
Yeah, sort of.
You gave me a reason. You gave me a reason to get up and get dressed.
Yeah, I mean, I've been living in sweats and t-shirts and stuff like that, and today I have long pants on. I mean, I could walk outside and people wouldn't say what a slob he is.
Oh, well, that's way above me.
I know it's been a difficult month. I mean, all of the Washington, D.C. performances have been canceled through the end of April, and the tour dates have either been canceled or postponed to other times. It must be tough for all of you.
Yeah, I mean, we got resoundingly told we were non-essential, but I have to agree, I do. You know, we know who the real heroes are now. It's the people who, you know, show up at the hospitals and the grocery stores and the truck drivers, and we couldn't live without them. So, yeah, and I noticed, too, that the Congress got out of town almost immediately when this hit, which was, like, fascinating to me that they basically declared themselves non-essential and left town, and when Nancy Pelosi needed a quorum, she had to actually round them up again.
So, I mean, this is nothing to laugh about when you think about it, the pandemic and all that, but when it's all said and done and you go back to putting out new material and going back on the road, are there any funny moments about this?
There are people, and I really admire them on Facebook or social media all over the place, that are finding humor. You know, somebody posted for April Fool's Day, the march to end March for social isolation, which the picture of the big crowd, everybody show up, and I thought, well, that's a pretty good April Fool's one. But you know, yeah, there's thank goodness for humor, and I think maybe the one thing that'll come out of this is that maybe a love song to Andrew Cuomo. You know, people are saying, you know, that Fauci is now, you know, a sex symbol. So there are some moments of humor.
I know that you're all kind of being idle at the moment, but are you working on material, or are you just taking a break?
Well, you know, it's funny you should say that, because I pulled out, and actually for purposes of this interview, it might be fun to discuss this, because I pulled out our running order of songs from less than a month ago. Like, this was what we were planning to do on Friday the 13th, which is basically the day Broadway, everybody shut down. We shut down our shows here in D.C., and I'm looking at the running order, and we did have one song about the coronavirus to the tune of Fever, but here's what's the song list. It was about Biden. Of course, you know, he's still going to be funny in the fall. There was a song about the investigation of Trump's phone call to the Ukraine. Do you remember that?
I do.
We had, of course, Bernie Sanders in the show. We had just written a song about Tulsi Gabbard. Now, people, I think when we come back, there's no doubt people are not going to be talking about Tulsi Gabbard.
Yeah,
but
I don't think
they're
not talking about her now, so, yeah.
At the time, she was kind of a little bit of the, like, why is she not dropping out? She's not dropping out, she's not dropping out. And so we wrote a song to Sandra Dee from Look at Me, I'm Tulsi G. And, you know, like, why am I not dropping out? And of course, we had songs about things that were at the time in the news. Even Pete Buttigieg was still being talked about a little bit because, you know, he had made quite a splash in the primaries. So, yeah.
So it's going to.
I don't know if we can do any of those.
Well, I guess you've got some time now that you can, you know, work on new material and hope that this COVID thing ends relatively quickly. I noticed that some of your members of the Capital Steps, who are musicians and actors and all of that, have really put some of their own materials out there. And I know it's got to be difficult for them because they're not working, but I've seen one who has recorded an album who's putting out a song here or there. And the Washington Post featured another member of the Capital Steps, Evan Casey, who does a lot of local theater. He and his wife, they're mainstays. In fact, Evan did a show for me a couple of weeks ago. We recorded it early in March. I think we recorded it well before the pandemic shut things down. And it was a 90th birthday salute to Stephen Sondheim. And he's done a lot of Sondheim musicals in Washington. And he was featured in the Washington Post along with his wife about how actors are surviving the crunch here. And it's not hitting the arts. I mean, it's hitting the arts groups in a big way, but it's certainly hitting the individual actors in an even bigger way.
Yeah, because, I mean, of all the things in life you worry about as an actor, this was never one of them that occurred to, I don't think, almost anybody. I mean, you always think about, oh gosh, you know, what if attendance is down, or what if, you know, there's also, our show isn't a hit, or what, you know, you think there's a lot of things that actors worry about. What if I don't get cast? But this one was just like completely, like, this was not a scenario that anybody thought about. At least I didn't. I don't know. Maybe one guy out in the, you know, the corner of Wyoming did or something, but not me. So it's the difficult thing is you don't know when it's going to end. So you could make a plan if you knew when it was going to end. You could audition for a show for the fall or whatever, but if you don't know when it's going to end, you're just, and in fact, right now we're sitting here trying to think about whether to cancel. I guess we're going to have to cancel May shows, but the mayor of D.C. has not yet come out with May as, you know, no social gatherings. She still just said through the end of April, which is way too optimistic, I guess, but we have to, you know, sort of follow her directives.
But one of the things that you've done, like some of the other arts and entertainment groups, is on your website every week you're putting up a song. Your social media is very strong. I mean, there's stuff all over YouTube. There's old songs and flashbacks and things like that on your Facebook page. And you're posting something, you know, some really funny cartoons and photographs along the way on Facebook. So you're keeping in the public's eye, which a lot of other groups can't do. So even though the material may not be the newest and the most up to date, it's out there.
Yeah, right. I mean, but it is a little hard for us because we are an ensemble group. So if you know, we have very few things that we could actually do sitting in a living room because our performers kind of need the music. They need so if we were to write a new song today about hoarding toilet paper, it'd be hard to record it because our pianists and our performers are in two different locations. And as good as things like Zoom and Skype are, they're not really, there's a time delay. It's hard.
Not only that, though, when you're doing political satire, it's one thing to be a Randy Rainbow and create a song and put it out there, or some of these other people that are all of a sudden taken to this kind of thing, but you're a group, and to perform, you need an audience response. I mean, it's one thing to listen to the Lion King's album, and it's another thing to see the show live and see the audience responding to things that when you listen to the album, you wouldn't think were funny, but the audience response makes them hysterical.
Right. I mean, have you been watching people like Trevor Noah and Stephen Colbert? Because they've been trying, and I appreciate it. But it is very odd to hear a great joke with no laughter.
Yeah, it's very different. And then, I mean, one of my guilty pleasures now that I'm getting to work at home a lot is I happen to like The View because I love to see them snipe at each other. But there's no applause. It's one stagehand clapping in the background and one camera person clapping. And it just, when they go at it, it's sort of like a prize fight where nobody's there.
Right. It is. Years ago, we used to do our albums in a studio, kind of more like a Randy Rainbow. We would do like a very highly produced, it would sound like the original song. And, you know, we'd use all the instruments and it was very polished and slick, like Weird Al does, you know. But we missed having audience laughter on those recordings. So we went back on our albums to doing them in front of an audience. Even though we could only do it with a piano that way, we just thought losing the instruments was worth it to get the audience reaction.
And if people want to catch it, I mean, they can get all the albums, including The Lion Kings, from your website. But you also do twice a year NPR specials called Politics Takes a Holiday, and you've posted those to the website. So people can go and download an hour of the Capitol Steps while they miss you.
Absolutely free. And we don't. And if you want to be nostalgic for the New Year's Eve show, is our last one up there, and of course, that was the days when a lot of these people, Elizabeth Warren and all, were still in the race, and we had every candidate covered, I believe, in that show. And you could kind of be a little wistful for the days when all we had to worry about was who we were going to vote for in a primary.
You always had a rather unique way of, since you had groups on tour, and you had a group in Washington, when new material was produced, it got faxed or emailed to the various troops on the road to learn. when things get back to a form of normalcy, how long will it take for you to get everybody back online and ready to roll?
Oh, they're used to learning them quickly. I'm thinking if we have to completely revamp the show, it'll be nice. I mean, we'll have a couple weeks' notice. People will start announcing. Mayors will start announcing, okay, it's all right for gatherings of X many people. I think things will come back gradually. So we'll have some notice. And I think our performers can learn a song in a couple days if they have to. But, you know, if we have to revamp the whole show, I think we'll have maybe a couple weeks' notice, and then it will be a little scary, but I'll tell you what, everybody will be so happy to be back, they won't care.
They won't care. In an election year, you guys are usually booked like crazy going into the election, and now you've postponed a lot of these tour dates and moved them into that time period. People can still book the Capitol Steps. Are you, as they say, sold out in terms of dates going into the end of the year?
Well, we actually had a lot of open time in August, so some people have moved their spring shows to August. We have one theater that could not do that because they have no air conditioning. I think that was up in Massachusetts somewhere.
It could have been, yeah.
Yeah, because they're used to doing a spring and fall season. But we have a lot of people that are moving to August. Some optimistic July and even June shows that we are still holding on to. And the fall is fairly booked, but there's dates here and there that people can still get. And we will do anyone we're invited to, because we'll be so happy to be back.
I bet. What are the chances of a Politics Takes a Holiday special for 4th of July? Is that...
I was thinking about that the other day and wondering, could we do that without an audience somehow, if we had to? We have to brainstorm on that one, because we usually record that the third week in June for the July 4th air date, and if we don't have an audience, I don't know what that would sound like.
Yeah.
We've never done that.
since you're you're isolated in Washington, D.C., are you used to being in at home and away from the workplace, or is it a challenge for you?
I'm used to coming into the office. Now, our office, as I call it, our world headquarters, the Capitol Steps have a townhouse just outside of Washington, D.C., and everybody has their own office with a door they can close. So we're pretty much isolated anyway, even if we're here, and I've been coming in to check the mail and things, and I think that's, you know, well within the rules. But, you know, there's not a lot of people calling to book shows or anything, because they're all waiting to see. Everybody's in a holding pattern.
Yeah, but hopefully you'll be back up and running really soon. I mean, we have to be optimistic here, huh?
Yes, we do have to, because, you know, actually, I think, if you can just look forward a couple weeks at a time. Okay, I can get through the next couple weeks of this, and then we'll see what happens, where we are then, and you kind of just have to look a little bit ahead and think, all right, I can get through that.
Terrific. Elena, we're out of time. We've been chatting with Elena Newport, the co-founder of the Capital Steps, a political musical satire group that's well-known in Western Massachusetts. They're always here in New England in one city or town or another, and always in Washington, D.C. And hopefully that schedule will resume sometime in the next month or two. Thanks for joining us.
It's all on the website, right?
Right, capsteps.com. I memorized that. Thanks for,
very good.
Thanks for joining us, Elena.
Okay, good talking to you, Mark.
Take care. Our next guest is Michael Cusick, who is the publisher of a new magazine called Different Leaf. Many people know Michael. He's often been referred to as the other mayor of Northampton. He's been a communications and marketing person in Western Massachusetts for a long time. He founded a magazine on the arts called Take and then moved on to Different Leaf, which is in its first year of publishing, and it deals with the cannabis industry. Good morning, Michael.
Good morning, Mark.
How are you doing in social distancing in Northampton?
Well, I feel like I'm sitting in the middle of a ghost town. It's so quiet down here. I live right downtown, so I've seen the effect of social distancing on the center of town sort of firsthand. It's incredibly quiet down here.
I can imagine with all the restaurants closed and no theaters, no shopping, and no students.
No, I know. Once the students left, that was sort of the first sign of what was to come. I usually get out for a nice long walk kind of early in the morning. That's sort of one of my new coping mechanisms with being inside all day, is to get out and for a nice long walk. And even I went out Saturday morning around 8:30 or 9, which would be an otherwise busy time. And I literally could have walked down the middle of Main Street and not encountered a car. It was so quiet. It's disturbing, you know, it's alarming in so many ways, but it's also a good thing because that means people are listening and staying home.
I go out for walks a couple of times a day because I can't go to the gym or do physical therapy. And the thing that I noticed the other morning was I live under the flight path to Bradley Airport, and there were no planes flying overhead. And it was very quiet. There's no traffic on the streets. And in walking, I'm starting to notice things like flowers coming up and all that. So I've been walking out in the middle of the streets because there's no traffic. And this morning I went out to walk about 5:30, quarter to 6. The sun is just starting to come up and it's very tranquil and quiet. And occasionally I moved a little too far into the street and some horn would honk. And I go, what are they honking at? They were honking at me.
You were the only obstacle out there.
Yeah, and I had an orange hat on. They must have thought I was one of those potholes, markers that kept moving. As a publisher, how is this impacting you? Because I know that a lot of advertising is not happening, and you work as a publisher with a group of people, and now they're all in separate places. How are you moving forward?
Well, in terms of production of the magazine, we're working on our spring issue right now, which is going to come out May 15th, and that was well underway. So most of the writing was done for that, and I'm an army of one with an amazing group of freelance talent that helps pull Different Leaf magazine together. So I'm used to working at a distance with the people I work with. So that wasn't the biggest adjustment, but, we had most of the writing done for this spring issue, and we were moving into the period of time where we would be going out and doing, we would be doing photography of the subjects in the magazine, setting up photo shoots and that sort of thing. And really the week that we were supposed to be doing most of our principal photography for this next issue was the week that nobody could get together. You know, the stay-at-home call came down. And so I am currently in the process of working with my art directors on this right now to figure out how to kind of what's our solution going to be for that? And so we may, you know, we do have some press photos from some folks, but we're looking at doing a lot more illustration in this issue. So it's definitely a creative challenge, and it's definitely going to be a very stylistic change for the magazine that usually has a lot of photography and it will have a lot less. You know, it's very interesting. Some parts of the cannabis industry in Massachusetts are allowed to stay open. So dispensaries that have a medical arm to them are allowed to sell cannabis to medical qualified medical patients in the state of Massachusetts. But for dispensaries that were adult use or recreational only, those dispensaries right now are closed. And so it remains to be seen how that's going to affect a lot of my advertisers going forward. And, you know, there is a push to get the governor to change his mind around that, both from within the industry and with consumers. So that remains to be seen if that'll change over time. But it is a very, like all industries, I mean, the cannabis industry has been affected by these shutdowns, and what the long-term effects will be, I think, is, like for many industries, still yet to see what's going to happen. Well, for magazines in general, it's been really it's a little bit chaotic right now,
as well as print, as well as newspapers. I mean, advertisers are just not moving forward, or they're putting their stuff out to social media instead.
For a lot of newspapers, particularly sort of the weekly arts and entertainment papers that still exist around the country, there is a major concern that newspapers that develop that are so reliant on arts and arts programming, you know, if that might be concerts or bands and bars or restaurant advertising, all of that advertising has simply vanished. And the great worry is this is going to be sort of an extinction level event for a lot of media that's out there. So if there's something that you really like and there's an option to subscribe to it, and you want it to stick around after this is all said and done, it's probably a really good idea to subscribe right now.
I certainly agree. I mean, I know in Western Massachusetts, there are some very vulnerable publications. And again, if people don't realize that you have a theater or a concert hall, that the restaurants and the shops and the galleries around it and the parking lots and all, and what have you, they all depend on people going to that concert or going to that play or performance. And if they're not going, and the advertising drops, these vulnerable publications will be gone.
Yes. And they won't be coming back anytime soon.
In the cannabis industry, I mean, in some other industries that are producing product, the product has a shelf life. For the people that are producing cannabis for either recreational use or medicinal use, does what they produce have a shelf life?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it would, definitely. I mean, it would have a shelf life. And so there are, you know, not only are there concerns about making sure that the products that are being created now are being made in a safe way, but it's also making sure that there are markets for them. I haven't had any particular conversations with, say, some product manufacturers that may make tinctures or edibles to see if that's impacted their production, but I'm sure they're keeping a close eye to see how their sales are changing over time, and they will adjust. I mean, one of the things about a legal cannabis market is there are a lot of guidelines around how the product is grown and processed. So even prior to COVID-19 being, you know, part of our daily existence, you know, the growing of cannabis is takes place in a very clean, a very, very, very clean environment. In fact, if you want to go in and see cannabis being grown up close, it usually involves getting into a Tyvek suit with a hairnet and booties on your feet, because this is a medical product for a lot of people, and so contamination is a major concern. And so cannabis growing has always been very clean and safe, and I think that the industry has done a really good job sort of responding to the additional demands of making sure that the products are safe when you have a pandemic going on.
Here's a dumb question, maybe, or maybe not. Is the growing of cannabis, is cannabis organic?
It can be grown organically. Yes, it can be grown organically. Certainly, you know, where we're going to see some impact this year would be particularly here in Western Massachusetts. There were a lot of outdoor cannabis cultivation operations that were scheduled to be getting plants in ground, and it'll be interesting to see what the impact is on that going forward. And a lot of that growing is organic. And the state of Massachusetts has really very, very strict guidelines around what kind of fertilizers and pesticides can and cannot be used with cannabis.
Now, I believe that the governor, with the guidelines and everything in the state, has allowed liquor to be sold. Is that true? I mean, I know beer.
Yes.
So if liquor can be sold and beer and wine can be sold and restaurants can offer now beer and wine in their takeout or in their carryout orders, how come cannabis is restricted to medicinal use and not recreational use?
Well, that is a very good question. And so there would be one of the inconsistencies. I think there are some real medical reasons why liquor stores should remain open for particularly people. You don't want to have an additional medical crisis for people who have an addiction to alcohol, who don't have access to it and end up detoxing, which would be a very bad medical crisis to add on top of the one that we already are experiencing. You know, the parallels between alcohol and cannabis are uneasy. There are a lot of people who use the adult use market to purchase cannabis that they use medically. And that may be because they've never gone through the process of getting a registered medical card, or they're employed in such a way that they don't want to have a record of them using medical cannabis or using cannabis of any kind. So there are a lot of reasons why the governor could consider opening adult use dispensaries again. One of his chief concerns has been that people would come over the border into Massachusetts to buy cannabis, and we're trying not to encourage that kind of behavior. So there's some question as to whether or not dispensaries could be just restricted to Massachusetts consumers, and I think that's one of the discussions that's happening now.
Though that would make sense, because you don't want people commuting in. I mean, I notice on 91 there are the signs, if you're coming into Massachusetts, at least coming northbound, please self-quarantine for 14 days.
Yes, I've noticed those as well. And the one time I've gotten in my car and went longer than up the block, I saw those on the highway. And so, yes, I mean, I think there's still an effort to make sure that adult use dispensaries will be open. And I don't think that battle is over yet. So it's one to keep an eye on.
Michael, we're just about out of time. If people are interested in getting more information about Different Leaf, how can they find it?
You can find us at differentleaf.com. And we've also just launched a new podcast that's called Different Leaf, the podcast. And it's available pretty much anywhere you can get a podcast.
Okay. And people can, the subscription, the next issue comes out in the spring, right?
The next issue will be coming out May 15th. And if you'd like to get that in the mail, it's a great time to subscribe.
Michael Cusick, publisher of Different Leaf, thanks for joining us this morning. Appreciate your insights. And hopefully when all of this lifts, we'll be able to sit down outside and have a pre-pool season cup of coffee.
Well, thanks so much for the invitation to come on and speak with you today. And I look forward to that coffee very soon.
Take care, Michael. You're listening to a very special program called How We're Doing, produced by ArtsBeat. It's a program that let you know how some of the people in various industries here in Western Massachusetts in our listening area are coping with the COVID-19 crisis, some of their advice on how to get through it. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. I'm Mark Auerbach. We are broadcasting on 89.5 FM WSKB and Westfield Community Programming Channel 15. We're broadcasting from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy. Peter Coles is our chief engineer, and we'd like to take this opportunity now to acknowledge some of the underwriters that make community radio and television possible here in Western Massachusetts.
Support for community radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield. Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Underwriting for community radio is provided by the YMCA of Greater Westfield. Every day, the YMCA strengthens the community through programs and services focused on youth development, healthy living, and social responsibility. For all the Y's many programs and services, visit us on the web at www.westfieldymca.org. The YMCA, 67 Court Street in downtown Westfield. We're more than a gym. We're a cause.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow, It's Tuesday, every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, It's Tuesday.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back, everyone, to this ArtsBeat Radio TV special called How We're Doing. I'm Mark Auerbach, your host. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. Our next guest on this segment is Diane Perlman, who is the executive director of the Berkshire Film and Media Collaborative. It's a Western Massachusetts organization that promotes filmmaking and video making here in Western Mass. Under their auspices, several major motion pictures have been filmed here in the Pioneer Valley and in the Berkshires. And there have been a lot of workshops and programs for videographers, filmmakers, and other members of the creative economy here in Western Mass. Diane, how are you doing out in the Berkshires?
I'm doing really well, Mark, considering. So thank you so much for having me.
Well, we haven't chatted in a long time. Has filmmaking and video making come to a halt here during this pandemic?
Yes, unfortunately it has. I mean, if you've ever been part of a video or a film, you know how closely everyone needs to work together. It really is pretty much a team effort when you're making videos. So, those kinds of larger productions or even smaller productions for our nonprofits have pretty much come to a halt.
How are you doing sheltering in place? You're one of these people that's traveling all over the globe, and here you are now in the Berkshires.
Well, I'm certainly saving on gas, that's for sure. We're taking it very, very seriously. I have a couple of friends who have had the virus and luckily made it through. And so I'm, here at home with my husband and one of my sons. And we feel very grateful that we're in Western Massachusetts where we can get out and hike. So I'm doing a lot of hiking with my dog and, some friends and their dogs, and we're keeping distancing. So in that respect, I feel very fortunate that we are not in a city and we're in, beautiful Western Massachusetts where we can get outside.
I'm very appreciative of the fact that I can go out and walk every day and there's not a lot of traffic. I'm not running into a lot of people. And being outside has been probably the best cure for social distancing and quarantining at home.
I would definitely agree. We're getting used to it like everyone else. I mean, spending more time on the computer doing business, but also it's been a time to reconnect with friends that I haven't been in touch with for a while. So that part, I guess, has been good in some ways. And I'm still determined to clean my office. I haven't gotten to that yet, but it's on the list.
Well, you know, I thought I should be cleaning mine, but then, and I always said, well, I never had any time. And now that I have time, I realize I just don't want to clean the office. I mean, it's just not our top priority. But one of the things I've noticed is a lot of people are putting video and music clips and stuff like that on social media. So some of these budding videographers and filmmakers are keeping busy getting their stuff out there. Unfortunately, they're not getting paid to do it. But what's happening to the creative economy here? Most of these people are out of work.
It's a very difficult time. You know, I'm on the board of another nonprofit, and I think that people are really looking, you know, to the government loans for payroll. I know a lot of people are on unemployment. I think it's, you know, there's a lot of trepidation out there right now in terms of what's next. And so just personally trying to support my friends who are in the creative economy, especially, as you know, Jacob's Pillow has canceled their season. Berkshire Theater Group is delayed till August. We still don't know what's going on with Tanglewood yet. And so I think everybody's just trying to hunker down and get over the hump, you know, of the peak of this virus, and hopefully we'll get into the summer season, maybe delayed, but it will happen for some of our cultural institutions.
Not only that, I would assume that the hotels and the restaurants and the galleries and all of the other industry that caters to tourists around the Berkshires will be impacted as well, because if you don't have 5,000 people going to Tanglewood on a given performance, those restaurants in Lenox are going to be empty.
Yes, it's a very difficult time. I was on a conference call with, I think it was about 200 cultural institutions from across the state or nonprofits. And it's definitely impacting. You know, it was in the news that Math Mocha let go, I think, 75% of their staff. And it's a very, very difficult time for everyone. And yes, the Berkshires relies on tourism so heavily, and we're getting into the tourist season. So it's, you know, everybody's trying to keep their spirits up, but we're worried. It's a hard time.
Now, a lot of the videographers and filmmakers that have come to live and work in Western Massachusetts, partly due to your efforts with Berkshire Film and Media Collaborative, where you've told people, yeah, we have talented people living in here that want to work here. What happens to them? Because there's not a union for freelancers. Are there any resources out there for these people?
Not really. A lot of them have been working hard. They have projects that are finishing up. They're not really out filming, but I know a lot of them have been filming, so they're in post-production on projects for the moment. You know, I think people are just hoping that shortly they'll be able to go out and film. I think there are ways to make videos. You know, either people have footage that they've already filmed, or they have still frames that can be edited together. So I think that, you know, some of our organizations can still make video, you know, maybe with voiceover instead of shooting, filming a narrator. So there are options. I think our community will be creative and figure that out to help organizations that need video in the coming months.
Now, you were let me interrupt here. You were involved in a video or film project in addition to Berkshire Film and Media Collaborative. Is that on hold, or is that proceeding?
Everything is, in terms of filming right now, or project moving forward, are sort of on hold right now. There's another project that is moving ahead. I mean, things are sort of moving ahead, but slowly. I think people are looking at, okay, things may get going in 3 or 4 months from now, and we don't want to stop our momentum. So those conversations are still continuing, just not at the same speed, I would say.
So now that you have a little more time on your hands, are you getting to watch movies and videos that you've missed along the way?
A little bit, yes. You know, one of the benefits of this is I've been having some Zoom conversations with old friends, and I feel like we're having the office water cooler conversations via the computer right now. So, you know, it's a lot of what are you watching, what series are you watching, and things like that. So I still have a list. Yeah, but I'm trying to catch up.
Have you discovered anything new that you want to share with people? Any new sites, any new films that people should go look for online?
Sure, a couple of things. I mean, I think there are some resources for people to see films now. I know that both the Berkshire International Film Festival, the Woodstock Film Festival, Tribeca Film Festival are all making films free for viewing. So that's really interesting. If people would like to catch up or maybe even see some independent films that they haven't seen, you know, that they wouldn't actually get access to unless they went to a festival. So those are three places that people can go, and most of them are streaming for free, which is really exciting. I think also I want to go back to the point that you were saying that people are making films. There's a lot of resources online, very, very simple iMovie application that people can learn to use very quickly as a resource if you would like to make your own video with your phone. It's really easy these days. So there's a lot of tutorials online that people could make their own videos. I just saw a family made a really cute video. It was they were dancing all day long, and they made this video and put it on Facebook, and it's just adorable. So I think, especially if you have kids at home, you know, to make films and learn how to edit them, it's pretty easy with the applications that are online these days.
Yeah, so out of all this could come a really fabulous movie called Pandemic or something like that that was shot in somebody's backyard here in Western Mass.
I think we're seeing a lot of budding filmmakers actually right now. And, you know, the cost to make films now, if you have a phone, it's a great way to be creative and learn how to tell a story. And I think we'll see a lot of new filmmakers coming out of this time. So maybe that's a good thing.
Prior to the pandemic, which sounds like ancient history, you know, when we were all there when the pandemic started, was there a lot of filmmaking activity happening in Western Massachusetts?
There was actually quite a bit. A lot of our nonprofit organizations, especially, were making videos with their seasons coming up. We also just launched in February something called the Community Film Fund, which is launching first in the Berkshires, which is a matching fund for our local nonprofits, our smaller nonprofits, to make videos for their branding and marketing and social media. And so there's been a lot of positive interest in that. And yes, in speaking with our filmmakers, I've noticed that there was a lot of activity going on here. So that's exciting. Both videos for organizations, and there were two or three short films that were being filmed in the area.
Are more of our organizations, our businesses, are they utilizing local filmmakers to make their commercials and their documentaries?
I think so. Part of what we're doing is really letting our community know that we have A-level talent here. You don't need to bring in filmmakers from New York or Los Angeles, that they're Academy Award winners down the street, or people that have made thousands of films or videos. So I'm finding that people are A, using local talent, and B, finding that it's a lot more affordable to use local talent when you don't have to bring in people from outside the area. So I'm finding that production is increasing using local talent, which is really exciting.
And there are a lot of people that have moved to Western Massachusetts with international film and video credits. I know Doug Trumbull has moved to Western Massachusetts. He's an Oscar winner. There are others, Karen Allen, who's an actor, director, and a filmmaker, is a resident here. The actors Jane Atkinson and Michael Gill. There's this whole community of people that have come here to live and work. So hopefully when this pandemic ends, they're going to be able to continue to live and work here.
It's very funny. I was just on the phone with Karen this morning about her film that she directed, A Tree, A Rock, A Cloud, that I was lucky enough to help her produce. And because we're looking at avenues for distribution. And, you know, she's so grateful to be here. She was also in an independent film, Colwell, which was nominated for an Independent Spirit Award. So she was out in Los Angeles for that award ceremony. I mean, I think you know, people are going to continue to stay here because they feel that the quality of life here is so wonderful, and they can go film around the world and come back here and really enjoy living in Western Massachusetts. They feel they can relax here and be themselves and have a great life. So, you know, that's why I think we have those people and that talent in the area.
Diane, I want to thank you for joining us, and we'll get to see this when the video part of this comes out, but the last time we had a chance to get together was at Barnes Airport in Westfield for a lunch back in the fall when we hadn't seen each other in months, and Patrick Berry and you and I got together for lunch, and you gave me a mood ring, and I want you to know that I'm wearing it today, and I got to admit that it's a dud. It has never changed color. It's always at blue, but today it's gray. So it's part of my wardrobe day in and day out. And every time I look at it, I think, wow, we're due another lunch.
Well, Mark, you know, you are so fashion forward, and I think you alone are going to bring back the mood ring. So I'm so glad that you're wearing it.
Well, thanks. We've been chatting with Diane Perlman from the Berkshire Film and Media Collaborative. And our last guest of the day today is a first responder. He is an EMT. He works as a firefighter. He's a second-year student at the University of Wyoming in Laramie. And in all transparency, I have to say that he has worked with me and my company for the last 4 years. He does a lot of the social media for many of my clients. Ben Jasek, good morning.
Good morning, Mark.
How are things out in Wyoming, sir?
Oh, it's a beautiful day today.
And are you at school? Are you riding an ambulance, or are you at the firehouse?
I'm actually doing my schoolwork online from my house right now.
Okay. You're unique in the fact, or at least unique to me, in the fact that you have this determination to become an EMT and to become a public servant when you were a teenager. And I remember that when you were just finishing high school before going off to the University of Wyoming, you went to EMT school and all of that. What motivated you to want to do public service like this?
I've always just loved, you know, helping people, and I figured getting my EMT would be a good way to start. And it was a really cool class. You know, it taught me a lot about myself and how to help others, and it just, I don't know, I just kind of always have thought it would be interesting to be an EMT, so I figured I'd try it, and I loved it. So.
And how did you take that EMT skills and become a firefighter?
Well, where I'm at, the only way to utilize the EMT skills would to be either work in the next town over, which is a 45-mile drive each way, or to join the volunteer fire department for the county I'm in. So I went with the one that was closer to home just because it was easier at the time. But it also means I had to get dual certified as a firefighter and work as a firefighter.
In fact, the Laramie newspaper wrote something about, I guess, the fire department was looking for volunteers, and you were written up as the youngest firefighter that they ever had.
Yes, when that was written, that was true. That was about 2 years ago, and at this point in time, I am no longer the youngest. We actually have quite a few that are younger than me.
And you're training some of them, correct?
Yes. Yep.
I know that the pandemic, at least from what we're being told, has really not reached Wyoming in the numbers that it has here in the Northeast, particularly in the New York, Connecticut area. And there's significant amounts here in Springfield. And we should also say, backtracking here, you're from Hamden, Massachusetts, so you're not a Wyominger except by transplant and going to school. But the COVID is not as bad there as it is here. Do you feel that you guys are prepared for this? Do you have enough equipment and supplies?
At this current point in time, I think we do. We have a lot of policies in place, and we've been getting a lot of feedback from the East Coast when people are using stuff or different techniques that'll work, and we've been modifying our plans as we go. I mean, I'm getting basically daily email updates of like new policies and procedures, and we have a stockpile of stuff that we, you know, we had before the pandemic that we've just kind of been saving now for pandemic use.
How often are you in the front lines?
About 2 days a week is when I'm running shift right now.
Have you run into COVID yet, or is it the usual gamut of the other things you would run into as an EMT?
It's been the normal running of stuff. I haven't had any exposure or possible exposure to COVID patients at this time.
Are people social distancing? We should say this is being recorded on April 6th. Are people social distancing in Wyoming, or are they pretty much walking about?
Oh, no. Everyone's following the social distancing and, you know, following the orders from the governor saying, you know, don't do unnecessary travel. Try and avoid being right next to each other. You know, stick to the 6-foot rules and everything else the CDC's saying. I mean, they're going out in public. They're wearing their masks and they're following, you know, stay away from everyone. And we're doing everything we can.
Yeah. A lot of people that are listening to this program are parents or grandparents who have a child or grandchild your age. Sophomore in college, no spring break, moving to online classes instead of, you know, in-class classes. And a lot of people look forward to going away to school like you did with the idea they're going to have a great social life. And all of a sudden, everybody's in their home bases. Do you feel that you're missing something or you've given up something?
I don't know if I'm giving up something, but it's just because I have contact with all my friends and everything through various social media platforms. But I would say it's definitely different than being able to, like, get together on campus and work through stuff and, you know, solve problems that way instead of having to FaceTime each other and, like, figure it out that way. So it's definitely different, but I don't know if I'm missing anything.
What about some of your friends that are younger who are going to miss their graduations or their proms? You have a brother who's about to graduate high school. He's going to probably miss his prom, and there may not be a graduation. Are people upset about that? Are they finding ways to get around it?
I definitely think people are kind of upset that they're going to be missing it from what I've seen. But at the same time, I think people are understanding. And I know schools have been saying they're going to try and make accommodations and you know, make stuff happen so that they can at least get some semblance of, you know, the graduation and prom and stuff.
How would you reassure the people that are listening here to follow these guidelines to make sure that they're safe? Can you tell anybody or give them advice on how they should do it and why they should do it that they're not getting from the media?
Honestly, the biggest thing is just follow the guidance from the governors of your state and the CDC guidelines. I mean, they're being updated daily with the various things, and follow your social distancing. If you do that, I mean, hopefully we can, you know, stem the increase in cases and everything will be able to slowly be figured out and return to normal.
You were lucky to do some training with FEMA. I know that you did some last summer, I believe, and then again recently. Has that better prepared you than some of your fellow EMTs to deal with this crisis?
I wouldn't say it's better prepared me in the EMS world just because of the nature of the training. It was more for the hazardous materials side of fire. But a lot of the skills are transferable, and I've been, you know, we've all been using them and just sharing what knowledge we have just to help each other out.
Did you ever think that at this point in your life you would be facing a pandemic with all of these challenges personally and professionally? Or did, I mean, a lot of us said we were never prepared. How do you feel?
I mean, I never thought I would be facing a, you know, pandemic and having to figure out different ways to treat patients while still being safe ourselves and doing all that. But, I mean, you got to, you know, expect something will be bound to happen while you're working, and this is my something.
Yeah, but you jumped into this and accepted the challenge of it. I mean, I would think that I know that you're in your family, your father was a police officer and just jumped into it, accepted the challenge and moved on. That's kind of a unique thing. Do you worry or fear at all, or do you just do your job?
Honestly, when I'm, you know, in my job, I'm there to treat other people. Obviously, you know, there's that sense of nerves that everyone has, but you kind of put it to the side and, like, you know, focus on treating your patient, doing what's best for your patient, and then you can worry about it afterwards.
Do your patients ever thank you for the treatment that you give them?
A lot of them have been lately, yes.
That's great. Ben, we're out of time. We've been chatting with Ben Jasek, who's an EMT and firefighter and a student at the University of Wyoming. Ben, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Mark, for having me.
Take care. So this wraps up another special edition of How We're Doing here on ArtsBeat. I'm Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles has been our chief engineer. With thanks to the folks here at Studio 120, and a special thanks to Ken Stomsky, who has his own programs here. But Ken Stomsky, over the last couple of weeks, has completely cleaned out and reorganized Studio 120 to the point that it can host live concerts and all of that. Join me on Fridays at 8 o'clock for our regular ArtsBeat programming. This special programming is made possible by members of the community who support community radio and television programming here at Studio 120 for the betterment of the community. We thank all of those underwriters. We'll see you on the next edition of ArtsBeat. We leave you with music from Marvin Hamlisch. He wrote it for a musical called Gene Seberg, which never opened, and it features Sarah Brightman. It's a nice song to get through the day with. See you next time.